God is my dad, experiencing our Heavenly Father, knowing our Heavenly Father intimately. As we all know, God is a Trinity, and He is Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. God in His perfect wisdom chose to exist as three persons, and we behold in the verses in the Bible that God exists as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And the three persons are all equal, and they have perfect fellowship with one another. And even from the first page of the Bible, we read, "Let us create man in our own image." Genesis 1:26-27, we read there. And why God chose to exist as three persons, it is God's wisdom. We cannot comprehend the entire or even a small fraction of God's wisdom. Actually, only as the Holy Spirit reveals to us, we can understand a little bit of what God is trying to reveal to our hearts. And one reason is God is love. So 1 John 4:8-16, we read that God is love. So if God has to be love, God has to be more than one person. God is love, not just after He began to create angels and human beings and all, but God was love even from all eternity, even before time began. So if love has to be love, it has to be shared. So there has to be more than one person. So God has to be more than one person. So God, in His great wisdom, is existing as God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And the wonderful thing, especially as people under the new covenant, that we can experience is God as our own Father, our own Daddy. Why it is important to see Him as, of course, you know, many a time we address Him as Father and all, but actually, as we know Him more intimately, we can, the Holy Spirit will give a cry in our hearts, saying, "Abba, Father." Most of you would be familiar with that verse in Romans chapter 8. Shall we turn to that? So I hope as we meditate these verses, we'll turn to those verses and note down those verses, so that even afterwards you can go through that and ask the Lord to minister to your heart through the same verses and impress that truth upon your heart more deeper. Romans chapter 8, verse 15, we read there that, "For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, Father." Abba is that Aramaic word, Aramaic language, Aramaic word for daddy. It is the, you know, just like in Malayalam we have Pidav, Appa. Pidav is a formal word, so that is a father. And Abba or Appa or Appacha or Daddy or Papa or Dad is the intimate word that we use. So Abba is the word that Jesus addressed the Father. You know, if you keep a finger here and turn to Mark's Gospel, chapter 14. Mark's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 36. There we read, "And Jesus was saying, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Abba, Father. So that is how Jesus addressed God the Father. So, you know, then we will know how much privileged and how blessed we are. Just as Jesus is, so are we in this world. 1 John 4:17, you can note down that verse. 1 John 4:17 says, just as Jesus is, so are we in this world. God has taken us to that position in Christ. When we are born again, we have the potential to be like Christ in this world. And of course, we can progressively, not we are attaining sinless perfection all on a sudden. Of course, sinless perfection will come only when Jesus comes back. But on this journey on this earth, we can become more like Jesus, more and more like Jesus, as we have deeper and deeper and closer and more intimate fellowship with the Lord. And we have, God has given us a position where that spirit of adoption as sons, that is what we read here in Romans 8:15, "For you have not received a spirit of slavery." It is not just, of course, you know, in one sense, we are a bond slave of Jesus, bond servant of God, bond slave of Jesus. Apostles themselves, addresses themselves like that. you know, in our attitude of humility, when we know that we are nothing before the Lord, we know that, you know, we are bound by His love, cords of love, we are a bond slave of Jesus. In one sense, that is true, but that is not a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but rather, here we read that, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, Father. So, you know, I can personally ask you that question. Have you ever called God Abba, Appa, Acha, or whatever you intimately call your earthly father, daddy? God is my dad. You know, what that has got a tremendous message in that, you know, in that phrase itself, in that small simple sentence itself. God is my dad. You know, even when Jesus taught us to pray, how? Matthew 6 verse 9, our Father in heaven. So, you know, how, you know, many a time if we observe the prayers of many believers, you know, knowingly or unknowingly, we tend to start prayer by Lord, Kartave, you know, so many, of course, that's all true. We can pray to Jesus, we can, we pray to the Holy Spirit. We see instances of that in the Bible, but Jesus has taught us that, you know, that in this way you pray. So in, one advantage of that, when we begin to pray, begin to address God as our dad, as our father in heaven, if you observed my prayers, you know, you would have seen by the Lord's grace, you know, always I'm used to that. You know, the one advantage is that, you know, when we go according to the scripture, you know, we have that sense of being a son or a daughter of the Almighty God, our Father, my Father in heaven, our Father, Snehendranya Pidavi. Of course, you know, in our personal prayer, we can use daddy and, you know, and even public prayer also, no harm in using, but, you know, that is how Matthew 6 verse 9, pray this in this way, not that exactly that wordings we need to repeat like a parrot, like many people unfortunately do, but that in this way you pray, in this manner, in this spirit, our Father, who is in heaven. So, I mean, in the Old Testament, actually, there is one verse, Isaiah 64:8, where we see God being referred to Father. If you turn to that verse, Isaiah chapter 64, let's say Isaiah chapter 64:6 says about our self-righteousness, all our own righteous deeds like filthy rags and all. Just after that, verse 8, but now, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, and you are our potter. All of us are the work of your hands. So very long reference there. But actually, throughout the Old Testament, if you see, I mean, actually, they are not addressing God as their Father and all. There is this long reference here, you are our Father. Israel collectively was just a congregation, and, you know, God was a master for them. Isaiah the prophet is referring, you are our Father, but actually when we come to the pages of the New Testament, without me telling you, all of you who would have read the New Testament, especially the Gospels and even the Epistles, that word, our Father, Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, our Father in heaven, our Jesus keeping on revealing the Father to us. There is this blessed verse in John's Gospel chapter 1. You know, I know I am referring many verses, but actually it is always good to ground our faith not in some man's words, but in the Word of God itself, so that, you know, as, you know, Paul also says that I did not come to you with superiority of wisdom or anything, but in the manifestation of spirit and power, 1 Corinthians 2, 5, he says that. So, I mean, our faith should rest in God's Word, if you, you know. I know that you know, of course, you have to use only 10 fingers when you listen to me. Many people say like that, you know, you have to keep one finger in John's Gospels first chapter, and if you have the other finger in First Corinthians 2, you can even note it down. First Corinthians 2 4 says that my message and my preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom, but in demonstration of spirit and of power, so that your faith would not rest in wisdom of men. Not because I say that God is our Father, but that is the Word of God. but on the power of God, not on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. And coming back to John's Gospel chapter 1 verse 18, there we read this blessed verse, "No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, only begotten God, who is in the bosom of the Father, He has explained Him." So who has explained to us the Father? The Lord Jesus Christ. And even today, Jesus only can explain to us, can reveal to us the Father. No one has seen God at any time. Literally, nobody has seen God with the naked eyes. But the only begotten, of course, we can behold the Lord in our spirit. Blessed are those who blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. So we can see God in our spirit, in the eyes of faith. We can see God, fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of faith. But actually, literally, nobody has seen God at any time. We can see with eyes of faith, in our spirit, we can behold Him according to the revelation that the Lord gives us. But the only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father, who is in the bosom of the Father. That means even while Jesus was on the earth, of course He was in the bosom of the Father as the Word of God. Jesus was in the bosom of the Father as the Word of God from all eternity. But even while He was on this earth, He continued to be in the bosom of the Father in that spiritual fellowship. "I and the Father are one," Jesus says in John 10:30. Not that they are not two persons, but they had that perfect spiritual union. "I and there are people in Christendom who says that only one person is there, the Jesus' name only is there, there is no Trinity and all. But actually, if you see the Word of God, it will be crystal clear to you. I'll show you some more verses, verse references and all. So, He who is in the bosom of the Father, Jesus was perfectly in fellowship with the Father, and even while on this earth, and that's why He was able to explain the Father to us. And today, when we experience God as our own daddy, as our own papa, if we are in the bosom of the Father, in that fellowship with the Lord, in our spirit, by our life and our words, we can also explain the Father to the unbelieving world around, and even to growing believers around us, so that they can also grow in this intimacy and this fellowship with the Father. Father and Jesus are two different persons. One proof of that we see in John 8 verse 12. Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." John 8:12. The Pharisees said to Him, "You are testifying about yourself, your testimony is not true." Then Jesus says, "Even if I testify about myself, my testimony is true, for I know where I came from." And then Jesus continues to say in verse 18, "Even in your law it has been written that the testimony of two men is true." Verse 18, "I am He who testifies about myself, and the Father who sent me testifies about me." So two persons, even in the law, two persons has to testify. So I am testifying and my Father is testifying. So there Jesus is saying that we are two different persons. Of course, John 10:30, Jesus says about "I and the Father are one." Not that they are one person, but although they are two persons, they are one in spirit. And just as the Father and Jesus are one, we have to be one with Jesus. Not that we are not separate person. John 17:21, Jesus' high priestly prayer, Jesus is praying that just as I and you are one, we want them also to be one. Not that, so just like that, that indicates a spiritual union. So here in John 8:16 and 17, very crystal clear that there is Trinity. There is Father, Son and the Holy Spirit are separate persons, and we see the instance of that throughout the Bible, especially in the New Testament. And how can we have the Father revealed to us? And even John's Gospel chapter 20, if you see, Jesus, one particular phrase Jesus used after His resurrection, John's Gospel chapter 20, to Mary Magdalene, Jesus says there, "My Father and your Father." So just after resurrection, Jesus is manifesting Himself to Mary Magdalene, who was longing to see Jesus, and who had that she was the first witness of Jesus' resurrection. John 20:17, Jesus said to her, "Stop clinging to Me, for I have not ascended to the Father, but go to My brethren and say to them, I ascend to My Father and your Father." So before that, in the Gospels, we read my father, and Jesus says, your father will care for you and all. But here, after Jesus' resurrection, you know, the truth is little more revealed. My father and your father. In one sentence, Jesus is saying, my father and your father, and my God and your God. And, you know, he is lifting us. He is lifting our position as his younger brothers. If you turn to Romans 8:29, we read that he is the eldest brother and we are his younger brothers. Romans chapter 8, we read there that he has predestined us for him whom he foreknew. Romans chapter 8 verse 29, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brethren. Jesus was the, you know, John 3:16, we read there that Jesus is the only begotten son. Who believes in the only begotten son will have eternal life, John 3:16. And but here also, after the resurrection, he became the first begotten son. You know, suppose actually a couple has one child, and that is the only child. After a few years we meet them, then they say that, well, this is not the only child, this is the first son and this is the second daughter. So like that, Jesus was the only begotten of the Father from all eternity, and after the resurrection, what happens? We became his younger brothers and sisters. John 8:29. We can call him, our eldest. We can address him as our eldest brother, our elder brother, and he is a foreigner. And Jesus and the Father, his first son Jesus, and we are all his children, and we are joint heirs with him. Here we read in Romans 8, verse 19, not 19, but rather verse 18, not even 18, I think it's, verse 17 rather, if children, Romans 8, 17, if children, heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, the same inheritance of Jesus. We are also joint heirs of fellow heirs with Christ, we have been made. And that is the privilege, you know, that God has called us to. Just like Jesus can address God as Abba, Father, you can also. If you have repented of your sins, and if you have surrendered your life to Christ, and has made Jesus the Lord of your life, then you are born again, and you are a younger brother or younger sister of Jesus, and you can call God as Father. In the Old Testament, actually, we read in Exodus and all, when God began to manifest his glory to them, they said that we do not want this God to speak to us, let Moses speak to us, that is enough. Because, you know, God's glory and his majesty and all was too overwhelming, overpowering for them. But today, in the New Testament, Jesus has torn the veil. Jesus, through his death, the veil in the temple of Jerusalem, Matthew 27, we read there that it was torn from top to bottom, which God the Father from heaven has torn from top to bottom, and he has inaugurated a way into the most holy place, to the very presence of God, where we can have this access to our Heavenly Father 24/7. We can even abide there and have continual fellowship with him. That is what the Lord desires. And how can we have this Father revealed to us? Of course, we can all theoretically know that our God is our Father. So I can call God my Father. Not like that. But actually, it is the Holy Spirit who has to reveal the Father to us. You know, one proof that God has revealed the Father to us is that the more we know God as our Father, our life would be secure and free of anxiety and cares. You know, if you see a person who doesn't have father or mother, an orphan child, you know, those children tend to be very insecure. Even actually, you know, many believers also, unfortunately, you know, they tend to become very insecure. People in the world are generally insecure because actually they don't have God as their, they do not know God as their Father. You know, there is this old poem of two robins, two little sparrows talking to each other. One bird is telling another bird, why these human beings are so worried and so anxious and so heavily burdened and all. They seem to be very restless and chaotic, agitated and anxious. And the other sparrow is telling the sparrow, oh, I don't know the exact reason, but probably they may not have a heavenly father as we have, is what the sparrow was observing and telling. So let no sparrow speak about that, speak like that about us when they see our life. You know, whether we know our father, you know, 1 John, if you turn to that first epistle of John towards end of the Bible, just before Revelation and Jude, 1 John chapter 2, we read there as knowing God as our Father. So there we read in verse 12, I am writing to you little children, because your sins have been forgiven you for his name's sake. So little children, as little babes in Christ, the primary thing that we need to know is that God is our Father. God has forgiven our sins. And then verse 13, I am writing to you fathers, even spiritually mature people, because you know him who has been from the beginning. You know the Father. One mark of spiritual maturity is the intimate knowledge of God as a Father. You know who has been from the beginning. I am writing to you young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I have written to you children. And then it says verse 13, even as little children in Christ, what we need to know. I have written to you children, because you know the Father. You need to know God as a Father. I am writing to you little children, because you know the Father. So, and again he is saying verse 14, I am written to you fathers, because you know him who has been from the beginning. I am written to you young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. And this verse also I'll show you from Matthew's Gospel chapter 11, where Jesus says, who has the Father revealed to them? Matthew chapter 11 verse 27. All things, Matthew 11:28, we all know, come to me all who are weary and heavy laden. So just before that, just the previous verse, Jesus says, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. No one really knows the Son except the Father. Nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wills to reveal him. So the Son of God, Lord Jesus, has to reveal the Father to us. And whom does he reveal the Father? Just the previous verse, verse 25. At that time Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them unto babes. Yes, Father, for this way was well pleasing in your sight. So only if we humble ourselves, like if we are wise and intelligent in ourselves, if we are very proud of our own, whatever, our own capabilities and talents, or our own, you know, even spirituality or Bible knowledge, or our own ministry, or our own degrees, or our own, you know, whatever. We can, you know, people can be proud of any little thing, and we all have the same flesh. But if we are wise and intelligent in ourselves, very strong in ourselves, we won't have the Father revealed to us. But if we humble ourselves like a little child, even the word reveal means apokalypto, that is a Greek word. Apokalypto, apo means separation, kalypto means veil. That means the veil has to be revealed. That means actually veil is indicating our flesh, our own self-will, Hebrews 10, 19 and 20. So when we surrender our self-will to the Lord, and the Holy Spirit does a, the Holy Spirit and the Word of God render a rending of the veil in our life. That means our, when we humble ourselves and give ourselves to the Lord as a living sacrifice, the Holy Spirit floods our heart, and then the Holy Spirit can reveal Jesus and the Father to us. You know, when Jesus was here, Jesus says the Son has to reveal him. Now it is the Holy Spirit. Jesus is revealing the Father through the Holy Spirit, through his Word. And when we are like an infant, like a little baby, we'll have the Father revealed to us more and more. And in order to become a little baby, what to do? Verse 28, come to me, I'll teach you how to become a baby. You are weary and heavy laden with your clever and intelligence and all. I'll give you rest like a little baby, like a wean child that rests against his bosom. Psalm 131, 1 and 2 says, and take my yoke upon you, and surrender to my word, and learn from me. I am gentle and humble, and I am like a little baby. And when you learn that humility from me, the more you learn to be humble like me, to walk with me and to humble like me, the Holy Spirit will come and fill your heart with the rest, with the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. The fruit of the Holy Spirit is peace, and you have the revelation of God as your Father. You can address Him above Father, Daddy. For whatever reason, whatever need or whatever problems in our life, we can always come to Him, Abba, Father. And Jesus says in John, with this we'll close John 15, I will not leave you as orphans, verse 18, you know, I will reveal the Father to you. That Jesus is saying there essentially. John 15 verse 18, Jesus says, Jesus is revealing to them that I am going to the Father. John 14, 18, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you, I am going to the Father, I will ask the Holy Spirit to come, verse 16 and all, I will ask the Father and He will give you another helper. I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. After a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me, but because I live, you will live also. In that day you will know that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. I will not leave you as orphans, I will reveal the Father to you, for that the Holy Spirit is there, the helper I am sending. In that day when you receive the Holy Spirit, that is what verse 20 says, John 14, 20. On that day, the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came upon them. Till that day they were like, they were behind closed doors and they were very frightened to face the Jewish people and all, and all the disciples were very frightened and timid. And then they began to pray in that upper room for those 10 days. And when the Holy Spirit came upon them, they had the revelation that, oh, we are not orphans. We have the Father in heaven. Whatever we need, we can boldly go to the throne of grace and we can tell boldly. Just like, you know, a little child will boldly come and tell all his needs to the papa and mommy. We can tell whatever we need to the Father, and whether our spiritual needs or earthly needs and everything. If we seek His kingdom and His righteousness, everything will be added unto you. So shall we humble ourselves, take time also to really surrender ourselves totally before the Lord and ask the Lord to fill you with the Holy Spirit. And we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit and again to have a more and more fresh revelation of God as our Father. Not as a distant Father whom we cannot see, who just sends some gifts to us on and off, but a Father whom we can hug and can rest in His bosom. When we are filled with the Holy Spirit, you know, we can experience the arms of embrace of the Lord, our Father, the security and comfort. You shall find rest for your soul, is what Jesus said there in Matthew 11, 29. So may the Lord reveal, may the Holy Spirit reveal the Father to us. And as we meditate the Word of God more and more, as we walk with the Lord, and as we begin to pray and address God as our Father, in our personal prayer, in our public prayer, we'll be able to address. And there are many portions, Matthew 6, verse 26 to 33, you can note down because of lack of time, I'm not able to go all over there. Jesus says, look at the birds of the air, their heavenly Father. Jesus doesn't say, your heavenly Father. Just I'll show you that, Matthew 6, Jesus says, your heavenly Father, verse 26, look at the birds of the air, that they do not sow nor reap or gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. So if I have some pet animals or pet birds in my house, if I am feeding my pet birds over there, how much more I will feed my children? Now, first of all, I will feed my children, then only I will feed the pet birds. So if the birds are fed by the heavenly Father, your heavenly Father is feeding them, so how much more He will feed you, whatever our earthly needs. And also Matthew 7, we all know that passage where from verse 7 to 11, ask and seek and knock, what man is there who, when his son asks for a loaf, verse 9, he will not give him a stone, if he asks for a fish, he will not give a snake. Matthew 7:11, if you then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give what is good to those who ask Him? He will give what is good. And what is that good? If you compare that verse with Luke 11:13, we know that there is a Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is, whatever is good in us is actually of the Holy Spirit. So He will give us the Holy Spirit more and more, so that He can reveal the Father to us. And whatever our physical, you know, the eyes of God, eyes of our Father are moving to and fro through the whole earth, that He would strongly support those whose hearts are completely His. Second Chronicles 16:9. That is that verse. Second Chronicles 16:9. Though God is moving to and fro, He is our Father, sovereign Father. Whatever we are need, you will know that. So shall we humble ourselves and surrender ourselves to the Lord and ask the Lord to fill us with the Holy Spirit to have a more and more fresh revelation of our Father in heaven. May the Lord help us. Amen.